Welcome to Linux for Beginners. This guide will focus on learning how to game on Linux. It also assumes that you know your way around your package manager and flatpaks. If you don't know what that means, then I highly recommend you check out the previous videos in this series to learn how to install packages for your system. I'm also assuming you're on an Arch-based distro. There is a high probability that there are equivalent packages in other distros, but this one will only show the Arch names for them. With that, let's get started with the list of packages I recommend for gaming. First, we have CacheOS Gaming Meta. It's probably the only package here that won't have a non-Arch equivalent, but what it does is basically install Wine, some libraries, and CacheOS versions of Proton. If you don't know, Wine is a translation layer for Windows programs that let you attempt to run them on Linux. Proton is an offshoot of that focused on gaming made by Valve, and is pretty much what we all use to play games on Linux. The CacheOS version of Proton further iterates on Proton, providing some useful fixes, so it's good to have on hand. Next we have ProtonPlus. I just explained what Proton is, but if you need a specialized version of Proton, the easiest way to install it into other programs is to use ProtonPlus. We'll use it in a bit, so definitely pick it up. If you've ever used RevaTuner on Windows, then Mango HUD is basically the equivalent, letting you have a detailed FPS counter and framerate limiter. You can customize its layout using Goverlay. If you like overclocking your GPU, check out LACT. If you do this, make sure you look up how to recover if you overclock too close to the sun. And the final official packages that I recommend are Lutris and or Heroic Games Launcher. It organizes your library outside of Steam and makes it much easier to manage games on an individual basis. I found that between the two, Heroic Games Launcher is more stable for third-party stores like Epic Games Store, while Lutris has EA App and Ubisoft Connect as options, while Heroic does not, which could make or break it for you. Outside of that, it doesn't really matter what you pick. Feel free to try both of them out and find the one that you prefer. I'm going to be walking through both of them, so feel free to skip the other. From the AUR, I recommend picking up FlatSeal. What this does is allow you to modify what permissions Flatpaks have. Usually when Flatpaks are installed, they should have all of the permissions they need, but there have been a few edge cases where it could come in use. The reason it's useful for gaming is that one of the permissions is to access GPU acceleration. If you install a game and it doesn't have that permission, you'll have to give it that so you can have a good experience. And finally, the last flat pack I recommend is Bottles. What it does is basically let you create a self-contained place to run applications from. While you can mess around with Wine to get a similar result, Bottles makes it super easy to set up a place where you can run apps with as many dependencies installed as you need. I personally use it to run apps if it's a one-time thing, like if I'm playing a bunch of random indie games that I'm only playing for one session, then I'll just run it through Bottles instead of taking the time to add it to Lutris or Heroic. Alright, assuming you have Steam installed, make sure it's closed, and then open ProtonPlus. In the top left, you should see the Steam logo here. If it's not there, click on the program there and switch it to Steam. Click on Proton-GE at the top, and click the download button next to Proton-GE latest. That's it! You've installed Proton-GE. What is Proton-GE, you might be wondering? Basically, on top of Valve's excellent version of Proton Experimental, Proton-GE has additional codecs and fixes that Valve hasn't yet, or legally can't, as a corporation, put into Proton. What this means is that in my experience, GE has been the most stable version of Proton I've used. While you're here, if you want to install it to any of the other programs like Lutris, Heroic, or Bottles, you might as well. Great, now open up Steam and go to your settings. Next, click on the Compatibility tab and change the default compatibility tool to Proton-GE, which should be in the list. If it's not there, make sure you've closed Steam completely and try again. Select that and you're probably good to go. That's pretty much going to be all you need to think about most of the time. Let's go over the not most of the time, where there's a fix that needs to be done. If you find something that isn't working, you can likely hop on ProtonDB and find out if the game is just not working or if there is a fix. Pretty much the only game that doesn't just work for me with Proton-GE is Killer Instinct. For some reason, specifically Proton 9.0 is the only version of Proton that worked for me. So let me show you how to switch compatibility for a specific game. It's really easy. Right-click the game in your library, and then click Properties. Go to the Compatibility tab and check the box to force the use of a specific compatibility tool. In this case, I wanted to switch to 9.0-4, so just scroll down and click on it and bam, good to go. The last thing we possibly need to go over is some of the more advanced tinkering shenanigans. Let's take a look at this ProtonDB report. Everything in this box, you want to put those in your Steam launch options. Again, in the properties of a game, in the general tab, you can see the launch options box. Typically, you can copy and paste exactly what people suggest into it, but let's break down some of the common things you can put in there. this option lets you switch from Proton translating instructions from DirectX calls to OpenGL instead of Vulkan, which is the default. So if a game has problems with Vulkan, this can sometimes help. This is an option you typically use for modding. Proton tends to use system DLLs instead of the ones in the folder for security, so you can override this by telling it, hey, look at dinput8.dll actually, and if your mod loader relies on that DLL, then you'll load it properly. If you're installing mods, you probably understand all of this, otherwise ignore this. This option literally just enables MangoHUD. If you want to customize it, however, put this before it. And in the quotation marks, you can put a bunch of different parameters separated by a comma with no spaces. For example, a very common use for MangoHUD is to limit FPS. In that case, the full command would be this. It enables MangoHUD with an FPS limit of 60, and the no display flag tells it to not actually show the FPS counter in-game, so it's only limiting your frame rate. These two launch options vary between distro to distro. For CacheOS, you want to use game-performance, while the other is used in any distro with game mode installed. For CacheOS, this launch option isn't typically that important. It basically just sets you to the high power performance for a while. Nothing crazy. Game mode is a little more involved with optimizations, but according to the CacheOS wiki gaming page, which I'll have linked in the description, that's unnecessary for CacheOS. If you like to use upscaling in your games, you might be happy to find out you can do so on Linux. You can upgrade most games to newer versions of their respective upscaling technologies using one of these commands. I haven't had any issues with FSR4 on Linux, and I'm really happy with it, so that's nice. This is the last command, and all you have to do is just tack it on at the end. It basically is just the game's exe, telling it to run all those options that you put on that exe. With launch options done, there's just one more thing that I want to mention. Some games have Linux native ports that aren't completely one-to-one compared to the Windows version. Project Outfox, for example, has a native version, but won't work with the skin I use because it's not on Windows, basically. If you force a compatibility tool, it'll actually just re-download the Windows version of the game and run it through Proton. Again, this is a very rare edge case, but if native Linux games ever have issues, you can just try running the Windows version through Proton. And that's all you really need to know for gaming on Steam. Remember, most of the time it'll run flawlessly out of the box, especially with Proton-GE. If something goes wrong, just check ProtonDB and you should be good. Everything I've shown you is mostly if you want to tinker yourself with launch options, and you probably won't have to remember them at all. Once you've made a configuration once, you can copy and paste it to other games if you want to. Alright, but what if your games aren't on Steam? That's what we have Lutris and Heroic for. First, we're going to start with Lutris. Go ahead and launch it. As you can see on the left side, they have support for some other game sources other than Steam, like Epic Games Store. Let's say you have a game from itch.io or something, just the loose files. We'll use Doki Doki Literature Club as an example again. Last time we used the .sh file, but if it were a regular Windows game, we would have only had the .exe file. So let's pretend that's what's going on. What you do is open Lutris, and in the top left click the plus icon. Click Add Locally Installed Game, and give it a name, as well as pick the runner. For Windows games, you should pick Wine as the runner. Next, go to the Game Options. Under Executable, select the .exe file that you're trying to run. Finally, go to Runner Options and switch the Wine version to GE Proton. That's it! You should be able to press Save, and the game will now appear in your library. You can click on it and press Play to start it up. Something to note is that if you want cover art to automatically download, you'll have to make sure the name that you enter when putting in your game exactly matches the title on Lutris.net. If I typed DDLC here, for example, it would not have downloaded the art, but still functioned. You can also provide your own cover and banner art if you want. Finally, if you want to make an icon for it on your desktop, if you click the up arrow next to play, you can create a desktop shortcut for it as well. Let's go ahead and lock in ProtonGE for all future installs by hovering over Wine on the left sidebar and clicking the gear that shows up. Here you can change what the default runner and system options will be every time you run a game. And that's it for Lutris! Next we'll check out Heroic Games Launcher. To install a game here, click Add Game, type in the name, pick the platform, which will likely be Windows unless you have a native Linux game, click on Show Wine Settings, and change the Wine version to ProtonGE. Finally, find the games.exe file and select it. If a game has an installer, use the Run Installer First button. But if it doesn't have an installer, just click Finished and you're done. If you want it to default to ProtonGE next time, then go to Settings, then Game Defaults, where you can change the Wine version. Let's say you want a different cover art for the game. Go to Steam Grid DB, then search your game name. Find the cover you want and right-click the Download button and copy the link. Next, click on your game and click the three dots in the top right. click edit app/game. Then paste the link into the app image text box. You should see it change automatically on the left. From here, just click finish and you're done. In the same triple dot menu, you can also click add shortcut if you want to make shortcuts really easily. Heroic doesn't use banner images or icons, so you don't need to worry about managing those. I kinda don't like that because it uses the cover art as the icon in your app launcher, so I hope they can eventually work that out. That finishes up Heroic Games Launcher. One more stop on the train, which is bottles. In bottles, create a new bottle, name it, and select gaming. Under runner, it doesn't really matter what you pick since you can switch as necessary, but I like using Proton-GE as per usual. Soda has worked a couple times as well where GE didn't though. Then just click create. The last thing you need to do is probably download some dependencies. If a program you want to use doesn't run, you can probably try to find the dependency here and try again. If you really want to, you can just download every dependency ever and have a super bloated bottle with as much compatibility as possible, but that'll typically be a waste of space and you should pick and choose as needed. That's it, now you can just click the run executable button and pick your .exe of choice and try to run it via bottles. In Dolphin, you can also right click and open .exes with bottles for convenience. And that's how you game on Linux. The next video in this series will be about using the terminal. If you're not interested, then I think you'll be content with not watching any further, since the next one will be kind of more difficult than what we've seen. But honestly, using a terminal is not that tough, especially if you're a good typer. A lot of people will probably stop here, but once you master it, it becomes even more convenient than using a GUI, and is why I fell so deeply in love with using my machine. But that'll have to wait for another day. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them below. I'm happy to respond to them. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you over there.